وأقول في القرآن ما جاءت به آياته فهو الكريم المنزال وأقول قال الله جل جلاله والمصطفى الهادي ولا أتأول
الحمد لله رب العالمين له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين أما بعد إن شاء الله تعالى This is our third episode and our second lesson. We've previously taken lesson number one and before that we did the introduction. So this will be our third episode, but our second lesson, inshallah ta'ala. In this lesson, inshallah ta'ala, I hope to cover 5 points, bi-idhnillahi al-kareem. There are 5 things, bi-idhnillahi al-kareem, I hope to cover, inshallah ta'ala, in this episode, bi-idhnillahi al-kareem. The first thing, inshallah ta'ala, is, ma huwa al-asru fi wujubi al-sawm. What is the evidence in the Qur'an or the Sunnah that show the obligation of fasting? What is the evidence for fasting? The scholars, they say, when they have discussions in books of fiqh, they say, ما هو الأصل في وجوب كذا وكذا. And what they mean by that is, ما هو الدليل. The word أصل is sometimes used as a دليل. So you saying ما هو الأصل في وجوب كذا وكذا or saying ما هو الدليل في وجوب كذا وكذا is the same. Because the word الأصل and الدليل are sometimes used as a synonym. They used one and the other. The same way that the word الأصل can mean الراجح, the strongest opinion. You can call الراجح the strongest. You could call it an asl, as Sahib al-Maraqi said, وَيُطْلَقُ الْأَصْلُ عَلَى مَا قَدْ رَجَحْ. That the word asl is sometimes used as that which is the strongest. That's a side benefit, inshallah ta'ala, for the students of knowledge to take down. So here the question is, what is the evidence to show fasting is obligatory? The evidence to show that fasting is obligatory is قَوْلُهُ تَعَالَى, the statement of Allah, يا أيها الذين آمنوا كتب عليكم الصيام كما كتب على الذين من قبلكم لعلكم تتقون. This ayah is evidence for the obligation of Ramadan. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, يا أيها الذين آمنوا, those of you who believe, Allah is talking to the believers, كتب عليكم الصيام, fasting has been made obligatory unto you as it was made obligatory on those who came before you. لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ, so you can attain taqwa and piety from the fasting. So Allah is talking to the believers and He is telling them that the fasting is obligatory upon them. So fasting is what? Obligatory. Because the word kutiba means furida. It was made obligatory on you. Also the other evidence is فَمَنْ شَهِدَ مِنْكُمُ الشَّهْرَ فَلْيَصُمْ. Anyone from amongst you who sees the entering of the month of Ramadan, فَلْيَصُمْ, he should fast. فَلْيَصُمْ means fast, it's a command. And the qa'ida, the principle, according to the scholars is that if Allah and His Messenger command you to do something, that command shows obligation. If Allah tells you, do this, it's an obligation, you have to do it. If the Prophet ﷺ tells you to do something, you have to do it, it's an obligation. And that's what we have in the ayah here. فَمَنْ شَهِدَ مِنْكُمُ الشَّهْرَ فَلْيَصُمْ. Anyone who sees the month, فَلْيَصُمْ. It's an obligation, it's a command. You're being told to do it. وَالْأَمْرُ يَقْتَضِ الْوُجُوبِ. And the command shows obligation. It shows obligation. So fasting is obligatory. Based on those two ayahs, it's obligatory. Also, the Prophet ﷺ, he mentioned to us that fasting is one of the 5 pillars of Al-Islam. بُنِيَ الْإِسْلَامُ عَلَىٰ خَمْسٍ. Islam is built upon 5 pillars. And from the 5 pillars that is built upon, one of it is what? Sawm Ramadan, the fasting in the month of Ramadan. And there's consensus amongst the ulama, the people of knowledge, that fasting is obligatory. Not two scholars differed whether Ramadan fasting it is obligatory or not. No two scholars differed upon it. Scholars have differed on many things. But from the things they differed upon is not whether fasting is obligatory or not. They unanimously, all of the scholars, accept that fasting is obligatory and that one must fast the month of Ramadan. Ibn Taymiyyah transmitted a consensus, Ibn al-Qayyim transmitted a consensus, Al-Imam al-Nawawi transmitted a consensus, Ibn Qudama transmitted a consensus, Ibn al-Mundhir transmitted a consensus, Ibn Hazm rahimahullah transmitted a consensus. Yani all of these ulama have mentioned that it's an obligation by unanimous decision that it's something a person must do. What about if a person rejects fasting? If a person rejects fasting, and he says that Ramadan is not obligatory on me, or Ramadan is not obligatory, that person is a disbeliever, they leave the fold of Islam. They are no longer considered a Muslim. What about if a person leaves Ramadan out of laziness? That person does not fast out of laziness, but they believe it's obligatory. But they left it out of laziness, or they left it because of desires, not because they are rejecting the obligation of fasting. The scholars, the overwhelming majority of scholars are of the opinion that person is a sinner who is falling into a major sin. There is a view transmitted from Al-Imam Ahmad rahimahullah that the person who leaves fasting is a disbeliever. Yani if he leaves it, he is a disbeliever. There is a view transmitted from Ahmad rahimahullah that states that. But the strongest opinion is, other than the salah, every other action, if the person leaves it, he's a sinner. Yani he's doing major sin, or he's doing a sin. The second point that I want to, inshallah ta'ala, cover bi'idhnillah in today's class, shurutu wujub al-sawmi, the condition, the prerequisite of fasting being obligatory. What is the prerequisite for Ramadan to be obligatory? Yani what must be in place before Ramadan can be obligatory upon a person? When does fasting become obligatory on an individual? So this is called what? It's called Shartul Wujub. Shartul Wujub is different from what the Fuqaha and the Usuliyin call Shartul Siha. Okay, we're not talking about Shartul Siha, and we're not going to go into what that is. We're now just going to talk about what is Shartul Wujub. Shartul Wujub means what is a condition for fasting to be obligatory on you. The first thing is, there are five. And the first one is Al-Islam. The person must be a Muslim. Fasting is obligatory upon the Muslim. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu kutiba alaykum siyamu. O those of you who believe, fasting was made obligatory unto you. So, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu. Islam is a prerequisite for the fasting to be obligatory on you. Number two, Al-Aql. The person has to have sanity. فَلَا يَصِحُّ صَوْمِ مِن مَجْنُونٍ. Fasting is not correct, and it's not accepted, and it's not obligatory on an insane person. The reason is because sanity takes the mind, and the mind is needed for the intention of fasting, as we're going to touch on later, inshallah ta'ala. One of the pillars of fasting is an-niyyah, intention. And if the person loses their sanity, they lose the intention, and if they lose the intention, their fasting is null and void. So because of that, the person who's insane, the fasting is not accepted from them, even if they fast, and it's not obligatory on them. And the evidence for that is the hadith al-Imam Abu Dawood narrated in his Sunan, that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, رُفِعَ الْقَلَمُ عَنْ ثَلَاثَةٍ. The pen is lifted from three. عَنِ الصَّبِيِّ حَتَّى يَبْلُغَ. The child until he reaches age of puberty. وَعَنِ النَّائِمِ حَتَّى يَسْتَيْقِظَ. And the one who is sleeping until he wakes up. وَعَنِ الْمَجْنُونِ حَتَّى يَفِيقَ. and the insane one until he regains consciousness. So the insane, fasting is not accepted from him, nor is it obligatory on him or her. The third one is al-bulugh, reaching age of puberty. فَلَا يَجِبُ الصَّوْمُ عَلَى الصَّغِيرِ. Fasting is not obligatory on the child. حَتَّى يَبْلُغَ, until he reaches age of puberty. لَكِنْ إِذَا كَانَ الصَّبِيُّ مُمَيِّزًا. If the child has reached سِنُّ الْتَمِيزِ, يعني he can distinguish one thing from another. He's smart, he's clever, he's 8, he's, you know, 7, 8, 9. And he fasts. صَحَّ صَوْمُهُ, his fasting is correct. And it's taken into consideration. So, but it's not obligatory on him. If the child hasn't reached age of puberty, fasting is not obligatory on him. But if he fasts and he's reached sinu tamiz, he's a mumayyiz, then his fasting is correct, inshallah ta'ala. Number four, al-qudratu ala sawmi, that the person has the ability to fast. فَلَا يَجِبُ الصَّوْمُ. Fasting is not obligatory. It is not obligatory upon مَنْ لَا يَقَدِّرُ عَلَيْهِ, the one who hasn't got the ability to do it. There's some people who are unable to fast. They don't have the ability. كَمَرِيضٍ لَا يُرْجَى بَرْءُ, like the sick person whose illness is chronic. And this is an illness where not hoping, or the doctors are saying that this is going to be forever, you're going to have this illness forever. This person is one who doesn't have the ability to fast. He hasn't got the ability to fast. So the fasting is not obligatory on him anymore. In order for you to fast, you have to have the ability to fast. And the fifth prerequisite that makes fasting obligatory on you is adamul mani'. There should not be a preventative factor preventing you from fasting, such as al-ha'idhi wal-nufasa. فَلَا يَجِبُ الصَّوْمُ عَلَى الْحَائِضِ وَالنُّفَسَ. The women who are on their menstruation or on their postnatal bleeding, fasting is not obligatory on them. Why? Because hayd, menstruation, and nifas are preventative factors that prevent a person from fasting. So because of that, a person or a woman who is on her menstruation, fasting is not obligatory on her. Fasting is not obligatory on a woman who is on her menstruation, or a woman who is on her postnatal bleeding. She's just given birth, she's on her 40 days. 40 days of bleeding after giving birth. That woman also must not fast. Fasting is not obligatory on her, and she shouldn't even try to fast, because she will be going against what Allah and His Messenger have set for her. So we've done, alhamdulillah, 2 points so far. The first point, I spoke about the ruling or the evidence to prove that fasting is obligatory. The second point, what I spoke about is the prerequisite for fasting to be obligatory on someone. Inshallah ta'ala, I'm going to swiftly move on to the third one, which is arkanu sawm. What are the pillars of fasting? Now, we have to know the difference between shart and rukun. Shart is a prerequisite, and a rukun is a pillar. The shart and the rukun have something in common, and they also differ on something as well. What they both have in common is, if a shart is missing, then the act is null and void. So if the prerequisite is missing, then the act of ibadah is null and void. The same way with the pillar. If the pillar is missing, then the act that you're doing is null and void. For example, the prerequisites, we mentioned five prerequisites for fasting. If one of it is missing, then the fasting is null and void. The same with the pillar, I mean the two pillars that I'm going to mention for fasting. If any one of them is missing, then the act is null and void. So they have that in common. The difference between the two is that the prerequisite is before the action. Whereas the pillar is part of the action. It's in the action. Okay? And both of them also have something else in common, which is if the person deliberately goes against any one of those two, they could be a sinner for it, or they are a sinner for it. Okay? I hope you understand this point, inshallah ta'ala. Now I'm going to go on to the third point in our today's lesson, or today's episode, which is arkanu sawm, the pillars of fasting. Arkanu sawm ithnani wahuma. The pillars of fasting are two, and they are, number one, an-niyyah, intention. Intention is a pillar. It's a pillar that every single one of us has to come with. We have to have the intention of fasting. And the evidence for this is the hadith of Imam Ad-Darqutni, narrated in his Sunan. Hadith of Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, مَنْ لَمْ يُبَيِّتِ الصِّيَامَ قَبْلَ طُلُوعِ الْفَجْرِ فَلَا صِيَامَ لَهُ. رَوَهُ الدَّارَقُطْنِي. Anyone who doesn't come with an intention before the sun rises, okay, فَلَا صِيَامَ لَهُ, that person hasn't got any fast. يعني before sunrise, you have to come with the intention. If you do not come with it, then don't consider that day a fasting. That's the first pillar. The second pillar is al-imsaku anil mufattirat, withholding and avoiding and abstaining from the things that break your fasting, which we will talk about inshallah ta'ala in today's session. In today's episode, you have to stay away from the mufattirat, the things that break your fasting. And we're going to mention that they are 10 things. You have to abstain from those 10 things. You need to stay away from those 10 things, or else your fasting will break. And the evidence for that is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what he said, ثُمَّ أَتِمُّ الصِّيَامَ إِلَى اللَّيْلِ. Complete your fasting until night, يعني until Maghrib. You have to complete it. Complete it here means to stay away from the things that break your fasting. So those are the two pillars that you have to come with. The first one is an-niyyah, intention. The hadith Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال, من لم يبيت الصيام قبل طلوع الفجر فلا صيام له. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, anyone who doesn't come with an intention before the sun rises for Fajr, فَلَا صِيَامَ لَهُ, that person doesn't have no fasting. رواه الدارقطني, الدارقطني narrated. The second one is الْإِمْسَاكُ عَنِ الْمُفَطِّرَاتِ, staying away from the things that break your fasting. And the evidence for that is قَوْلُهُ تَعَالَى ثُمَّ أَتِمُّ الصِّيَامَ إِلَى اللَّيْلِ. Complete your fasting until night, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said. Now we're going to go into the fourth point that I want to inshallah ta'ala cover in today's episode, bi'idhnillahi al-kareem, which is mubtilatu al-sawm. Mubtilatu al-sawm, the things that nullify your fasting. What are the things that nullify a person's fasting? The things that nullify a person's fasting are 10. And we're going to go through those 10 inshallah ta'ala. The first one is al-aklu amdan, to eat deliberately. The second one is وَالْشُرْبُ عَمْدًا, it is to drink deliberately. The third one is الْجِمَاعَ, to have sexual intercourse. If a person eats or drinks deliberately or has sexual course, their fasting is broken. As for if the person, he drinks or he eats and he has forgotten, فَلَا يَبْطُلُ صومه, his fasting is not then null and void. And a person forgot, they went and they just drank, or a person ate and they forgot that they are fasting, then this inshallah ta'ala does not nullify your fasting. Based on the hadith of Imam al-Bukhari and Muslim, both narrated, من نسي وهو صائم فأكل أو شرب فليتم صومه فإنما أطعمه الله وسقاه. Anyone who forgets and then goes and eats or drinks, and he's in a state of fasting, فَلْيُتِمَّ صَوْمَهُ, complete your fasting. فَإِنَّمَا أَطْعَمَهُ اللَّهُ وَسَقَهُ, Allah is the one who gave you this rizq. It's Allah who is providing for you. It is Allah tabarak wa ta'ala who is nourishing you. carry on your fasting. You're not held account for it. The fourth is ta'ammudul qay, to deliberately vomit. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, وَأَنِسْتِقَاءَ فَلْيَقَضِي. And the one who deliberately makes himself he makes himself deliberately vomit, then he needs to bring back that fasting. رواه أبو داود والترمذي. Imam Abu Dawood and Tirmidhi both narrated this. So deliberately making yourself vomit breaks your fasting. Like some people do. Some people, whenever they eat, they like to bring out whatever they eat. إنزالوا عن مباشرتي أو الاستمناء. Inzal means ejaculation. This ejaculation can either come from mubashara, having coming into contact with your spouse or your partner, and then that results to some ejaculation, or it coming from masturbation. Whichever way it comes, that the person ejaculates, and of course it's deliberate, and the person is doing it deliberately, then this person's fasting is null and void. Whether it comes from kissing or touching, or it comes from, it doesn't matter. This breaks your fasting. But if the person has a wet dream whilst they are sleeping, then this is not held, you're not held account for it. If it happens to you whilst you're sleeping in Ramadan, then this is not what you held account to. It's when you make yourself reach ejaculation. Number 6 and number 7, which is al-hayd wal-nifas. Hayd and nifas, both of them have the same ruling, which is they break your fasting. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said in the hadith, alaysa idha hadat lam tusalli wa lam tasum. Isn't the woman, when she's on her menstruation, she doesn't pray nor does she fast? So the nifas takes the ruling of the hayd. The nifas and the hayd take the same ruling. Number 8 is al-junoon, insanity. If the person, jannah fi nahari Ramadan, he becomes insane whilst fasting, yabutulu sawmuh, his fasting becomes null and void. Because he loses what? He loses the intention. The intention is a rukun, it's a pillar. And once you become insane, you are no longer conscious. So you lose the intention, which makes the fasting null and void. Number 9 is ar-riddah, apostasy. A'adhana Allahu minha, may Allah protect us from it. فَمَنْ اِرْتَدَّ عَنِ الْإِسْلَامِ فَقَدْ أَفْطَرَ وَلَا خِلَافَ فِي ذَلِكَ. Anyone who apostates from Islam, leaves the religion of al-Islam, that individual's fasting becomes null and void, and there's no dispute amongst the scholars regarding it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said in the Qur'an, وَمَنْ يَرْتَدِدْ مِنْكُمْ عَنْ دِينِهِ فَيَمُتْ وَهُوَ كَافِرٌ فَأُولَٰئِكَ حَبِطَتْ أَعْمَالُهُمْ فِي الدُّنْيَا وَالْآخِرَةِ وَأُولَٰئِكَ أَصْحَابُ النَّارِ هُمْ فِيهَا خَالِدُونَ. Anyone who apostates from their religion and they die in that state of kufr, فَأُولَٰئِكَ حَبِطَتْ أَعْمَالُهُمْ. Those are the people whose actions are null and void, and it nullifies in this world and the hereafter, and they are from the people of the hellfire, and they will stay there for eternal. Number 10, which is the last type, is حُقْنُ الْغِذَائِيَّةِ. If a person takes insulin, or if a person takes nutritional substance that are plugged into his body, which takes the place of the food. يعني he takes an injection, and this injection gives him glucose and it gives him nutrition. This breaks your fast because it's a substitute for food. But if what you're taking does not give you nutrition, nor does it's not a substitution for food, then this does not break your fast. Okay? This does not break your fast. But if it's a supplements that go into your body that you inject yourself into, or even you take droplets into your mouth, or all of this, they break your fasting because they do exactly what food does. Those 10 are the 10 things that break your fasting. يعني they are considered and they are seen as مبطلات الصوم, the nullifiers of fasting. Now inshallah ta'ala, we're going to go into the last part of today's episode, which is لِمَنْ يُبَاحُ الْفِطْرُ فِي رَمَضَانِ. Who are the people who are allowed, who are permitted to, inshaAllah ta'ala, not fast in Ramadan? They are excused. They don't have to fast. The obligation does not apply to them. And they are five asnaf, five types of people. يُبَاحُ الْفِطْرُ فِي رَمَضَانِ لِخَمْسَةِ أَصْنَافٍ وَهُمْ. To break your fast is only permitted for five types of people. They don't have to fast in the month of Ramadan. The first one is الْمَرِيضُ وَالْمُسَافِرُ وَالْحَامِلُ وَالْمُرْضِعُ وَالْعَاجِزُ عَنِ الصَّوْمِ لِكِبَرٍ. And the fifth one is الْحَيْضُ وَالْنُفَسَ. Those are the five. Those five, they don't have to fast. Let's start with the first one. The first one is al-maridu. And al-musafir, they have the same evidence. The maridu is the sick one, and the one who is a traveler. Allah says in the ayah, وَمَنْ كَانَ مَرِيضًا أَوْ عَلَى سَفَرٍ فَعِدَّةٌ مِنْ أَيَّامٍ أُخَرٍ. The one who is sick and the one who is a traveler, they have to bring it back another time. So they don't have to fast. That's the evidence for the sick one and the traveler. Al-hamil wal-murdi'u, the one who is pregnant or the one who is breastfeeding. She doesn't have to fast. Wal-ajizu ani sawmi likibarin, and the one who is unable to fast because of an old age. The evidence for number three and number four. Number three is what? Al-hamil wal-murdi', the one who is pregnant or breastfeeding. That's number three. And number four is wal-ajizu ani sawmi likibarin, the one who is unable to fast because of old age. So three and four, the evidence for that is that which Al-Imam Abu Dawood narrated in his Sunan. لِحَدِيثِ سَعِيدِ بْنُ جُبَيْرٍ عَنِ بْنِ عَبَّاسٍ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى عَنْهُمَا. That Abdullah ibn Abbas, when he came to the ayah, وَعَلَى الَّذِينَ يُطِيقُونَهُ فِدْيَةٌ طَعَامُ مِسْكِينَ, he said, كَانَتْ رُخْسَةً لِلشَّيْخِ الْكَبِيرِ وَالْمَرْأَةِ الْكَبِيرَةِ وَهُمَا يُطِيقَانِ الصِّيَامِ أَنْ يُفْطِرَ وَيُطْعِمَ مَكَانَ كُلِّ يَوْمٍ مِسْكِينًا وَالْحُبْلَ وَالْمُرْضِعُ إِذَا خَافَتَا أَفْطَرَتَا وَأَطْعَمَتَا. He said, Abdullah ibn Abbas, this is a rukhsa for the old man. وَعَلَى الَّذِينَ يُطِيقُونَ فِدْيَةٌ طَعَامُ مِسْكِينَ. The ayah is talking about those who are unable to fast. They are going to give fidya every day. They're going to take care of a miskeen every day. One miskeen every day. So Abdullah ibn Abbas tells us, who are these people? He said, كَانَتْ رُخْصَةً لِلشَّيْخِ الْكَبِيرِ. So the old man or the old woman who is unable to do it. وَهُمَا يُطِيقَانِ الصِّيَامَ أَنْ يُفْطِرَ وَيُطْعِمَ مَكَانَ كُلَّ يَوْمٍ مِسْكِينًا وَالْحُبْلَ, the one woman who's pregnant, he said. وَالْمُرْضِعُ, the one who's breastfeeding. إِذَا خَافَتَا, if they are both scared, أَفْطَرَتَا وَأَطْعَمَتَا. If both of them are scared, the pregnant woman and the breastfeeding woman are scared, they both have to break their fast, and each day they give food to a miskeen. The last one, which is the fifth, is al-ha'idu wal-nufasa, the women who are on their menstruation or postnatal bleeding, which is the fifth one. This is based on the hadith of Abi Sa'id al-Khudri, which I mentioned before, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said, the hadith is found in Bukhari and Muslim, alaysa idha hadat lam tusalli wa lam tasum fadhalika nuqsanu diniha. That the woman who's on her menstruation or her on her postnatal bleeding, that woman, she doesn't pray nor does she fast, and that is what reduces from her religion, and that is why her religion is reduced, as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said. So those five quickly are what? Al-maridu wal-musafiru wal-hamilu wal-murdi'u wal-ajizu an as-sawmi likibarin wal-ha'idu wal-nufasa. These five. The first one is a sick individual. The second one is the traveler. The third one is the pregnant or the breastfeeding mother. The fourth is the elderly individual, male or female, doesn't matter. And the fifth one is the woman who's on her menstruation or her postnatal bleeding. Those, they don't have to fast. Fasting is not obligatory on them. They are excused. today's class, inshallah ta'ala, that was the plan. I wanted to cover those five jurisprudent rulings. I hope I've given the topic justice. Anything I might have said that was wrong or incorrect is from me, as shaytan, and Allah and His Messenger are free from it. Subhanakallahumma bihamdik, ashadu an la ilaha illallah, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayh.
Assalamu alaikum. If you're enjoying these videos and you'd like to keep up to date with all of the courses we're going to be running, make sure you head over to amauathome.com.